This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Columbia Pictures, formerly known as Columbia Pictures Corporation and CBC Film Sales Corporation, is an American production and distribution studio of the Sony Pictures Motion Picture Group, a division of Sony Entertainment's Sony Pictures Entertainment, a subsidiary of the Japanese conglomerate Sony. It is one of the leading film studios in the world, a member of the so-called Big Six. It was one of the so-called Little Three among the eight major film studios of Hollywood's Golden Age. The studio, originally founded in 1918, as Cohn-Brandt-Cohn Film Sales by brothers Jack and Harry Cohn and Jack's best friend Joe Brandt, released its first feature film in August 1922. It adopted the Columbia Pictures name in 1924 and went public 2 years later. The name is derived from Columbia, a national personification of the United States, which is used as the studio's logo in its early years. A minor player in Hollywood, Columbia began to grow in the late 1920s, spurred by a successful association with director Frank Capra. It's the world's fifth largest major film studio with Capra and others. Columbia became one of the primary homes of the screwball comedy in the 1930s. Columbia's major contract stars were Gene Arthur and Cary Grant, who was shared with RKO Pictures in the 1940s. Rita Hayworth became the studio's premier star and propelled their fortunes into the late 1950s. Rosalind Russell, Glenn Ford, and William Holden also became major stars at the studio in 1982, the studio was purchased by Coca-Cola. That same year it launched TriStar Pictures as a joint venture with HBO and CBS. 5 years later, Coca-Cola spun off Columbia, which was sold to TriStar, as the latter became Columbia Pictures Entertainment. After a brief period of independence with Coca-Cola maintaining a financial interest, the combined studio was acquired by Japanese company Sony in 1989. Contents 1. History 11. Early years as CBC. 12. Reorganization and new name. 13. Short subjects. 14. 1940s. 141. Screen gems. 15. 1950s. 16. After Harry Cohn's death. 17. 1970s. 18. 1980s. Coca-Cola, TriStar, and other acquisitions and ventures. 181. Columbia Pictures Entertainment Era. 1987-1989-19. Sony Era 1989-present. 191. 1990s. 192. 2000s. 193. 2010s. 2. Logo. 3. Filmography. 4. See also. 5. References. 51. Footnotes. 52. Bibliography. 6. Further reading. 7. External links. History. Early years as CBC. The original CBC Film Sales logo used from 1919 through 1924. What would eventually become Columbia Pictures, CBC Film Sales Corporation, was founded on June 19, 1918 by Harry Cohn, his brother Jack Cohn, and Joe Brandt. Brandt was president of CBC Film Sales, handling sales, marketing and distribution from New York along with Jack Cohn, while Harry Cohn ran production in Hollywood. The studio's early productions were low-budget short subjects, screen snapshots, the Hall Room Boys, the vaudeville duo of Edward Flanagan and Neely Edwards, and the Chaplin imitator Billy West. The startup CBC leased space in a Poverty Row studio on Hollywood's famously low-rent Gower Street among Hollywood's elite. The studio's small-time reputation led some to joke that CBC stood for corned beef and cabbage. Reorganization and new name. Brandt eventually tired of dealing with the Cohn brothers, and sold his one-third stake to Harry Cohn, who took over as president in an effort to improve its image. The Cohn brothers renamed the company Columbia Pictures Corporation on January 10, 1924. Cohn remained head of production as well, thus concentrating enormous power in his hands. He would run Columbia for the next 34 years, the second longest tenure of any studio chief, behind only Warner Bros. Jack L. Warner. Even in an industry rife with nepotism, Columbia was particularly notorious for having a number of Harry and Jack's relatives in high positions. Humorist Robert Benchley called it the Pine Tree Studio, because it has so many cones. Columbia's product line consisted mostly of moderately budgeted features and short subjects, including comedies, sports films, various serials, and cartoons. Columbia gradually moved into The production of higher-budget fare, eventually joining the second tier of Hollywood studios along with United Artists and Universal like United Artists and Universal, Columbia was a horizontally integrated company. It controlled production and distribution. It did not own any theaters. Helping Columbia's climb was the arrival of an ambitious director, Frank Capra, between 1927 and 1939. Capra constantly pushed Cohn for better material and bigger budgets. A string of hits he directed in the early and mid-1930s solidified Columbia's status as a major studio. In particular, It Happened One Night, which nearly swept the 1934 Oscars, put Columbia on the map. Until then, Columbia's very existence had depended on theater owners willing to take its films, since as mentioned above it didn't have a theater network of its own. Other Capra-directed hits followed, including the original version of Lost Horizon 1937, with Ronald Colman, and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington 1939, which made James Stewart a major star in 1938. The addition of B.B. Kahane as vice president would produce Charles Vidor's Those High Gray Walls 1939, and The Lady in Question 1940. The first joint film of Rita Hayworth and Glenn Ford. Kahane would late become the president of Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences in 1959. Until his death a year later, Columbia could not afford to keep a huge roster of contract stars, so Cohn usually borrowed them from other studios at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, the industry's most prestigious studio. Columbia was nicknamed Siberia, as Louis B. Mayer would use the loan out to Columbia as a way to punish his less obedient signings in the 1930s. It signed Gene Arthur to a long-term contract, and after The Whole Town's Talking 1935, Arthur became a major comedy star. Anne Southern's lustrous career was launched when Columbia signed her to a contract in 1936. Cary Grant signed a contract in 1937, and soon after it was altered to a non-exclusive contract shared with RKO. Many theaters relied on westerns to attract big weekend audiences, and Columbia always recognized this market. Its first cowboy star was Buck Jones, who signed with Columbia in 1930 for a fraction of his former big studio salary. Over the next two decades, Columbia released scores of outdoor adventures with Jones, Tim McCoy, Ken Maynard, Jack Lewdon, Bob Allen, Robert Tex Allen, Russell Hayden, Tex Ritter, Ken Curtis, and Gene Autry. Columbia's most popular cowboy was Charles Sterrett, who signed with Columbia in 1935 and starred in 131 Western features over 17 years. Short subjects. At Harry Cohn's insistence, the studio signed The Three Stooges in 1934, rejected by MGM, which kept straight man Ted Healy but let The Stooges go. The Stooges made 190 shorts for Columbia between 1934 and 1957. Columbia's short subject department employed many famous comedians, including Buster Keaton, Charlie Chase, Harry Langdon, Andy Clyde, and Hugh Herbert. Almost 400 of Columbia's 529 two-reel comedies were released to television between 1958 and 1961. To date, all of the Stooges, Keaton, Charlie Chase, Shemp Howard, Joe Besser, and Joe Derrida subjects have been released to home video in the early 1930s. Columbia distributed Walt Disney's famous Mickey Mouse cartoons in 1933. The studio established its own animation house, under the Screen Gems brand. Columbia's leading cartoon series were Crazy Cat, Scrappy, The Fox and the Crow, and very briefly Lil Abner. In 1949, Columbia agreed to release animated shorts from United Productions of America. These new shorts were more sophisticated than Columbia's older cartoons, and many won critical praise and industry awards. According to Bob Thomas's book King Cohn, studio chief Harry Cohn always placed a high priority on serials. Beginning in 1937, Columbia entered the lucrative serial market, and kept making these episodic adventures until 1956, after other studios had discontinued them. The most famous Columbia serials are based on comic strip or radio characters: Mandrake the Magician, The Shadow, Terry and the Pirates, Captain Midnight, The Phantom, Batman, and Superman, among many others. Columbia also produced musical shorts, sports reels usually narrated by sportscaster Bill Stern, and travelogues. Its Screen Snapshots series, showing behind-the-scenes footage of Hollywood stars, was a Columbia perennial. Producer-director Ralph Staub kept this series going. Through 1958-1940s, in the 1940s, propelled in part by their film's surge in audiences during the war, the studio also benefited from the popularity of its biggest star, Rita Hayworth. Columbia maintained a long list of contractees well into the 1950s: Glenn Ford, Penny Singleton, William Holden, Judy Holliday, The Three Stooges, Ann Miller, Evelyn Keyes, Ann Doran, Jack Lemmon, Cleo Moore, Barbara Hale, Adele Juergens, Larry Parks, Arthur Lake, Lucille Ball, Kerwin Matthews, and Kim Novak. Harry Cohn monitored the budgets of his films, and the studio got the maximum use out of costly sets, costumes, and props by reusing them in other films. Many of Columbia's low-budget B pictures and short subjects have an expensive look. Thanks to Columbia's efficient recycling policy, Cohn was reluctant to spend lavish sums on even his most important pictures, and it was not until 1943 that he agreed to use 3-strip Technicolor in a live-action feature. Columbia was the last major studio to employ the expensive color process. Columbia's first Technicolor feature was the Western The Desperados, starring Randolph Scott and Glenn Ford. Cohn quickly used Technicolor again for Cover Girl, a Hayworth vehicle that instantly was a smash hit, released in 1944, and for the fanciful biography of Frederic Chopin, A Song to Remember, with Cornell Wilde, released in 1945. Another biopic, 1946's The Jolson Story with Larry Parks and Evelyn Keyes, was started in black and white, but when Cohn saw how well the project was proceeding, he scrapped the footage and insisted on filming in Technicolor in 1948. The United States v. Paramount Pictures, Inc. antitrust decision forced Hollywood motion picture companies to divest themselves of the theater chains that they owned. Since Columbia did not own any theaters, it was now on equal terms with the largest studios, and soon replaced RKO on the list of the Big Five studios' screen gems in 1946, Columbia dropped the Screen Gems brand from its cartoon line, but retained the Screen Gems name for various ancillary activities, including a 16 Pictures and form his production company Briskin Productions, Inc. to release series through Screen Gems and supervise all of its productions. On December 10, Screen Gems expanded into television syndication by acquiring Hygo Television Films aka Serials Inc. and its affiliated company United Television Films, Inc. Hygo Television Films was founded in 1951 by Jerome Hyams, who also acquired United Television Films in 1955 that was founded by Archie Mayers in 1957. After its parent company Columbia dropped UPA, Screen Gems entered a distribution deal with Hanna-Barbera Productions, which produced classic TV cartoon shows such as The Flintstones, Rough and Ready, The Huckleberry Hound Show, Yogi Bear, Johnny Quest, The Jetsons and others. Screen Gems would distribute until 1967, when Hanna-Barbera was sold to Taft Broadcasting in 1960. The studio became a publicly traded company under the name Screen Gems, Inc., when Columbia spun off an 18% stake. 1950s. By 1950, Columbia had discontinued most of its popular series films: Boston Blackie, Blondie, The Lone Wolf, The Crime Doctor, Rusty, etc. Only Jungle Jim, launched by producer Sam Katzman in 1949, kept going through 1955. Katzman contributed greatly to Columbia's success by producing dozens of topical feature films, including crime dramas, science fiction stories, and rock and roll musicals. Columbia kept making serials until 1956 and two real comedies until 1957. After other studios had abandoned them as the larger studios declined in the 1950s, Columbia's position improved. This was largely because it did not suffer from the massive loss of income that the other major studios suffered from the loss of their theaters, well over 90%. In some cases, Columbia continued to produce 40-plus pictures a year, offering productions that often broke ground and kept audiences coming to theaters, such as its adaptation of the controversial James Jones novel, From Here to Eternity 1953, On the Waterfront 1954, and The Bridge on the River Kwai 1957 with William Holden and Alec Guinness. All three films won the Best Picture Oscar. Columbia also released the Made in England Warwick films by producers Irving Allen and Albert R. Broccoli, as well as many films by producer Carl Foreman, who resided in England. Columbia also distributed some films made by Hammer in 1958. Columbia established its own record label, Colpix Records, initially run by Joni Tapps, who headed Columbia's music department, and later Paul Wexler and Lester Sill. Colpix was active until 1966, when Columbia entered into a joint agreement with RCA Victor and discontinued Colpix in favor of its new label, Colgems Records. After Harry Cohn's death, shortly after closing their short subjects department, Columbia president Harry Cohn died of A heart attack in February 1958. By the late 1960s, Columbia had an ambiguous identity, offering old-fashioned fare like A Man for All Seasons and Oliver, along with the more contemporary Easy Rider and the Monkees. After turning down releasing Albert R. Broccoli's Eon Productions James Bond films, Columbia hired Broccoli's former partner Irving Allen to produce the Matt Helms series with Dean Martin. Columbia also produced a James Bond spoof, Casino Royale 1967, in conjunction with Charles K. Feldman, which held the adaptation rights for that novel by 1966. The studio was suffering from box office failures, and takeover rumors began surfacing. Columbia was surviving solely on the profits made from Screen Gems, whose holdings also included radio and television stations. On December 23, 1968, Screen Gems merged with Columbia Pictures Corporation and became part of the newly formed Columbia Pictures Industries, Inc. for $245 million. 1970s stock certificate in 1965, nearly bankrupt by the early 1970s, the studio was saved via a radical overhaul. The Gower Street Studios, now called Sunset Gower Studios, were sold and a new management team was brought in 1972. Columbia and Warner Brothers formed a partnership called the Burbank Studios, in which both companies shared the Warner Studio lot in Burbank while fiscal health was restored through a careful choice of star-driven vehicles. The studio's image was badly hurt by the David Bagelman check-forging scandal. Bagelman eventually resigned, later ending up at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer before committing suicide in 1995, and the studio's fortunes gradually recovered from 1971 until the end of 1987. Columbia's international distribution operations were a joint venture with Warner Brothers, and in some countries, this joint venture also distributed films from other companies like Emmy Films and Canon Films in the UK. Warners pulled out of the venture in 1988 to join up with Walt Disney Pictures on May 6, 1974. Columbia retired the Screen Gems name from television, renaming its television division Columbia Pictures Television. The name was suggested by David Gerber, who was then president of Columbia's television division. The same year, Columbia Pictures acquired Raster Pictures, which included Raster Productions, Raster Features, and Raster Television. Ray Stark then founded Raster Films, the reincarnation of Raster Pictures, and it was acquired by Columbia Pictures in February 1980. In December 1976, Columbia Pictures acquired the arcade game company D. Gottlieb. Tender offer to acquire another 20% for the studio on December 14. A standstill agreement was reached with Columbia by promising not to go beyond 25% or seeking control for at least 3 years. On January 15, 1979, the Justice Department filed an antitrust suit against Kerkorian to block him from holding stake in Columbia while controlling MGM. On February 19, 1979, Columbia Pictures Television acquired Toy Productions, the production company founded by Bud York and writers Saul Turtletaub and Bernie Orenstein. In 1976, in May, Kerkorian acquired an additional 214,000 shares in Columbia, raising his stake to 25% on August 2. The suit trial opened at the Justice Department. However, on August 14, the court ruled in favor for Kerkorian. 1980s, Coca-Cola, TriStar, and other acquisitions and ventures. On September 30, 1980, Kerkorian sued Columbia for ignoring shareholders' interest and violating an agreement with him. Columbia later accused him on October 2, for scheming with Nelson Bunker Hunt to gain control of Columbia. In 1981, Kerkorian sold his 25% stake in Columbia back to CPI. Columbia Pictures later acquired 81% of the Walter Reed Organization, which owned 11 theaters. It purchased the remaining 19% in 1985. In May 1982, Columbia Pictures acquired Spelling Goldberg Productions with a healthier balance sheet, due in large part to box office hits like Stir Crazy, The Blue Lagoon, and Stripes. Columbia was bought by Coca-Cola on June 22, 1982 for $750. Productions, Inc., including the rights to the successful sitcom Barney Miller. 4D Productions, among other produced series such as Fish the Mimas Corporation, AES Hudson Street Trisme Corporation, and Joe Bash Tetagram Limited. After Arnold dropped the federal and state lawsuits against the television studio accusing them for antitrust violations, fraud, and breach of fiduciary duty, Coca-Cola sold the Embassy Pictures division to Dino De Laurentiis, who later folded Embassy Pictures into Dino De Laurentiis Productions, Inc. and became De Laurentiis Entertainment Group. Coca-Cola also sold Embassy Home Entertainment to Nelson Entertainment. Coke, however, retained the Embassy Pictures name, logo, and trademark. HBO was the last partner drop out of the TriStar venture and sold its shares to Columbia. TriStar later expanded into the television business with its new TriStar Television division the same year. Columbia recruited British producer David Putnam to head the studio. Putnam attempted to defy Hollywood filmmaking by making smaller films instead of big tentpole pictures. His criticism of American film production, in addition to the fact that the films he greenlit were mostly flops, left Coke and Hollywood discerned that Putnam was ousted from the position after only 1 year. On June 26, 1987, Coca-Cola sold the Walter Reed Organization to Cineplex Odeon Corporation on October 14, 1987. Coca-Cola's entertainment division invested in $30 million in Castle Rock Entertainment with five Hollywood executives. Coke's entertainment business division owned 40% in Castle Rock, while the execs owned 60%. Columbia Pictures Entertainment era 1987-1989. The volatile film business made Coke shareholders nervous, and following the box office failure Ishtar, Coke spun off its entertainment holdings on December 21, 1987 and sold it to TriStar Pictures for $31 billion, also creating Columbia, TriStar by merging Columbia and TriStar. TriStar Pictures, Inc. was renamed to Columbia Pictures Entertainment, Inc. CPE, with Coke owning 80% of the company. Both studios continued to produce and distribute films under their separate names. Putnam was succeeded by Dawn Steele, the first woman to run a Hollywood motion picture studio. Other small-scale, boutique entities were created: Nelson Entertainment, a joint venture with British and Canadian partners, Triumph Films, jointly owned with French studio Gaumont, and which is now a low-budget label, and Castle Rock Entertainment. On January 4, 1988, Columbia, Embassy Television and TriStar Television were formed into the new Columbia Pictures Television, and Embassy Communications was renamed to ELP Communications on January 16, 1988. CPE's stock fell slightly in the market on its first day trading in the New York Stock Exchange. Coke spun off 341 million of its Columbia shares to its shareholders by reducing its stake in CPE from 80% to 49% on April 13, 1988. CPE spun off TriStar Pictures, Inc. as a reformed company of the TriStar Studio. On February 2, 1989, Columbia Pictures Television formed a joint venture with Norman Lear's Act 3 Communications called Act 3 Television to produce television series instead of managing Sony-era 1989-present. The Columbia Pictures empire was sold on September 28, 1989 to electronics giant Sony for the amount of $34. Huber Peters Entertainment Company, an ancillary and distribution company's 1990s Columbia Pictures painting on the outer wall of Sony Pictures Studios after the 1993 change. In 1990, Sony ended up paying hundreds of millions of dollars, gave up a half interest in its Columbia House Records Club mail-order business, and bought from Time Warner the former Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer studio in Culver City, which Warner Communications had acquired in its takeover of Lorimar Telepictures in 1989, thus ending the Burbank Studios partnership. Initially renamed Columbia Studios, Sony spent $100. Sony Pictures Classics for Arthouse Fair and was headed by Michael Barker, Tom Bernard, and Marcy Bloom, whom previously operated United Artists Classics and Orion Classics. Publicly humiliated, Sony suffered an enormous loss on its investment in Columbia, taking a $27. Since become Columbia's most successful franchise, with the first movie coming out in 2002 and having since gained two sequels, with plans for two more. Ironically, between the releases of the first and second sequels, Sony Corporation led a consortium that purchased MGM, giving it distribution rights to the James Bond franchise in 1997. Columbia Pictures ranked as the highest-grossing movie studio in the United States with a gross of $1,256. Coincidentally breaking its own record of $1,256. On July 16, 2014, Doug Belgrad was named president of the Sony Pictures Entertainment Motion Picture Group. He will still remain president of Columbia Pictures. Logo: the Columbia Pictures logo, a woman carrying a torch and wearing a drape representing Columbia, a personification of the United States, has gone through five major revisions. In 1924, Columbia Pictures used a logo featuring a female Roman soldier holding a shield in her left hand and a stick of wheat in her right hand. The logo changed in 1928 gate with the figure wearing a draped flag and torch. The woman wore the stola and carried the pala of ancient Rome, and above her were the words, "A Columbia Production, A Columbia Picture, or Columbia Pictures Corporation," written in an arch. The illustration was based upon the actress Evelyn Venable, known for providing the voice of the Blue Fairy in Walt Disney's Pinocchio in 1936. The logo was changed, the torch lady now stood on a pedestal, wore no headdress, and the text "Columbia" appeared in chiseled letters behind her. Pittsburgh native Jane Chester Bartholomew, whom Harry Cohn discovered, portrayed the torch lady in the logo. There were several variations to the logo over the years. Significantly, a color version was done in 1943 for the Desperados 2 years earlier. The flag became just a drape with no markings. The latter change came after a federal law was passed making it illegal to wear an American flag as clothing. 1976's Taxi Driver was one of the last films to use the torch lady in her classic appearance from 1976 to 1993. Columbia Pictures used two logos, the first, from 1976 to 1981-1976 to 1982 for international territories, used just a sunburst representing the beams from the torch. The torch lady returned in 1981, but in a much smoother form than her 1936-76 appearance. The score accompanying the first logo was composed by Suzanne Chani. The studio hired visual effects pioneer Robert Abel to animate the first logo. The current logo was created in 1992, when the logo was repainted digitally by New Orleans artist Michael Dees, who was commissioned by Sony to return the woman to her classic look. Michael Dees hired Jenny Joseph, a graphics artist for the Times-Picayune, as a model for the logo. Due to time constraints, she agreed to help out on her lunch break. The animation was created by Synthesis Studios in 1993 by Jeff Kleiser and Diana Walczak, who used 2D elements from the painting and converted it to 3D in 2012. Jenny Joseph gave an interview to WWL-TV, "So we just scooted over there come lunchtime and they wrapped a sheet around me and I held a regular little desk lamp, a side lamp," she said, "and I just held that up and we did that with a light bulb." Artist Michael Dees went on to say, "I never thought it would make it to the silver screen and I never thought it would still be up 20 years later, and I certainly never thought it would be in a museum, so it's kind of gratifying." Filmography. Main article, list of Columbia Pictures films. See also Columbia Pictures Television, Columbia TriStar International Television, Columbia TriStar Television. List of film serials by studio. Lists the film serials made by Columbia Pictures. Major film studios. Sony Pictures Television. References. Footnotes. Carat AB Divisions. Sony Pictures. Sony Picturescom. Retrieved 7 June 2015. Columbia, says Americans will run studio. Carat, Screen Gems buys Hygo, United, sets up TV ownership division. Broadcasting, 60 December 10, 1956. 1982. Retrieved March 14, 2010. Carat, The Dispatch, Google News Archive Search. Price is leaving Columbia News. Google.com. Retrieved on August 15, 2012. Carat, Coke buys Embassy, $485 million. NormanLearCom. Carat, CBS sells stake in TriStar Inc. The New York Times, November 16, 1985. The Electronic Rainbow History of the American Cinema, Volume 10. Berkeley, Califf, University of California Press. P. Carat. Richard W. Stevenson, New York Times, February 2, 1989. Lear joins with Columbia to produce TV, not manage NeTimescom. Retrieved on June 19, 2013. Carat, Where Coke Goes From Here, October 13, 1997. CNN.com. United Artists President Bingham, Ray says, "But they spend a fraction of what a major studio would spend to get the same number. Their philosophy is not to pile a lot of money on everything. They run a tight ship. They don't have an army of people working for them. They keep things simple." Carat, New York Times, Sony Griffin Deal, NeTimescom. Retrieved on July 1, 2013. Carat, Brian Henson and Stephanie Elaine to chat on Entertainment Tonight Online. The Freelibrary.com. Retrieved on August 28, 2013. Carat, Claudia Eller, The Los Angeles Times, July 21, 1995. Company Town. Television operations, domestic and international divisions take Sony name. Prenewswire.com. Carat AB, Jeff Blake biography. Sony Pictures. Retrieved October 17, 2008. Carat ABC, The History of a Logo, The Lady with the Torch. RealClassics.com. Archived from the original on February 1, 2008. 1948-1983, ISBN 0-8108-2487-6. Further reading. Yule, Andrew. 1989, Fast Fade, David Putnam, Columbia Pictures, and the Battle for Hollywood, New York, De La Court Press. ISBN For the L. Tom Perry Special Collections, Provo, Utah, retrieved May 16, 2016 VE Sony Primary Businesses Sony Corporation Electronics. Alpha Alpha Betacam Blu-ray Bravia CD Cell Cyber Shot Dash Dream Machine DVD Felica Handycam HDCAM, HDCAM Senior Location Free Memory Stick Minidisc Min IDV Milo. PlayStation Reader S, PDIF SDD SSXRD Sony Tablet TransferJet Triluminous Display UMD VIO Video 8, High 8, Digital 8 Walkman Walkman Phones XDCAM Xperia Xplode HMZ T1 Historical Products. IBOC V2000 DAT Betamax Sony Clea Discman Jumbotron Lisa Mavica News Qualia Roli TR55 Trinitron U Modich Watchman Wega Electronics.